I would like to invite the special guest of this convention, the person that you have been waiting for, someone with over 30 years experience. Yeah. Well, you might be disappointed if you're expecting someone else, but we have someone even better. So, without any further ado, I'd like to invite Ellie Rae Hennessy to join us on the stage.
Goes. So I guess a bit of getting into the business is If you love it, whatever it is you love, if somebody says that you can't do it, know that you can do whatever your heart tells you you can do. If you love it, be authentic to yourself, and you will always be in the business that you love. Don't let anyone define you.
So then we're like, okay, fine.
No, that's the question.
So I need to look around for that. There's nothing to do. The seat went along the way, so we'll just do this, just put it together. And then we only lost the lecture.
My little pony, my best friend in real life, is about to say, Jermaine! Woo! Yes! Yes! Hell, Luna, hell, Rarity, hell, Derby, hell. Yes, he's my best friend in real life, actually. We've known each other for, well, I don't want to tell you how long we've known each other, because stuff gives away the dinosaur that I black. I go to Vancouver, where my little pony is recorded. I live in Toronto. It's a 5.5-hour flight. That's how big Canada is.
You
go from halfway Toronto to Vancouver, 5.5 hours. Same distance that it was to come here. So it's very, very far. And I went out and she would have...
It's quite hard to do.
She'd have gone to conventions for my little pony. She had gifts given to her, plushy toys and pony horns and the most phenomenal fandom and things that she had experienced. And I go, and I said, what is this? And she's like, my little pony. I'm like, what do I know about my little pony? And then I started to investigate my little pony and get to know about the family. I said, I'm going to be in that shop. And remember, I have this voice. I have this voice. And it's like, well, the ponies are, you know, Pinkie Pie and Cupid. No, they're no, really. You know, they're not right, you know, voices I like. Oh, I've got to work really hard to get on that show. I'm going to be on the show. I'm going to be on the show. I'm going to be on the show. And then auditions came up for Madge and a Rep and Miss Vane and several of us, Nebula, a bunch. And I auditioned for them. And I got callbacks, which is a big deal. I said, oh, I'm so close. I'm so close. And then I got Miss Vane and I was so excited because if you've watched season 7, when Miss Devane is introduced, Campfire Tales, who here has seen Campfire Tales? Who introduces Miss May?
Rarity,
my best friend, introduces me. She's as her favorite, like, as her favorite legend. I mean, I can't make this up. She's my best friend in real life. And she is...
So
I mean, come on. Is that the universe saying, I should be in this bedroom, I should be voicing for you guys, I should be loving you guys through my best friend? That's right. That's right. So, that's how I got in, that's how I found it, and it's just been nonstop ever since. And I'm ready to play a whole bunch of other ponies that I can't talk about. Yeah. Nasty pony. I've been nice to you, but I think it's not being a dangerous thing. What do you think? Think it's positive. Your eyes peeled. Keep your eyes peeled.
Yes. We were friends.
I don't
want to get it. Oh yeah, as I said, the fandom for me is the show. Without the fandom, the show would not be happy. So it is all of you guys, every pony in the room, everybody who leads the show. It's your heart that makes this show happen. Hasbro would not have the kind of success they have right now without you guys. You are the show. You are the ponies. That's what they're talking about. When they say friendship is magic, it really is everything you do. It has nothing to do with age. It has nothing to do with geographic location. It has nothing to do with religion or anything. It doesn't matter who you are. Everybody has a place and no one is left out. And you will always find something for yourself. I'll get it. I'll get it. It's Tabitha. No, it's the fandom. I heard about it. I've never seen anything like it. I've done thousands of characters over 37 years in animation, in gaming, in anime. And I've said, I've never seen a bad building like this one. How much of my own personal self do I put into this thing? Well, I do believe that beauty is not, it's skin deep, it goes way beyond what you look like. It's not about that. And I think, you know, Mystique believes in things that are magical. She was the most beautiful, most magical pony of the legends. And she gave it all away so that everybody else could be beautiful. And I think in a world that we live in right now, where we're losing touch with one another, we don't communicate like this. We don't talk, we're on our phones all the time, we're singular. We feel despondent, we feel afraid. We feel lonely, we feel sad, we feel depressed. And the only thing that is really connecting us is the fact that beauty can be given out. Beauty can be given out through communication. That's what the human connection is. And in a show like this, I think Miss Maine giving away her physical beauty, but also using her magic to battle evil, like a dragon comes out and battles the negative, because people want to take things from you. They want to take, so the evil queen, of course, she battles her and said, no, you can't do that to everyone, and then made her beautiful, as well as the entire land. She gave it all away and became very, some would say, ugly. But I think that beauty, what she became in giving that kind of beauty out to make everyone else feel alive and feel happy and feel magical themselves, that is what my job is. My job is to voice the characters, but to also reach people in the fandom and say, you are beautiful. Every single one of you in this room, every single one of you in this fandom, is incredibly beautiful and magical, and you are not alone. And you're not alone.
The thing is, the
that's right. That's right. She became jealous of her beauty and jealous of her magic. That's right. And she just basically said, Miss May said, no, you don't have to be jealous. And she became ugly. She became ugly because she was grasping. She was
grasping. It was like, it was so
self-aware. Beautiful, exactly right. Everybody has that. We all do. Who's beautiful here? Every hand should be in the air. Every hand should be in the air. You are all beautiful. Don't forget that, for sure. Absolutely. Okay, so, well, there's so many writers on the show. I mean, you guys would love it so much. If you ever get the chance to come to a recording in Vancouver, we do the Children's Wish. Does everybody know what the Children's Wish Foundation is? Yes, with Angel Wings. So a lot of kids, that it's their wish to be involved in a recording of My Little Pony or meet the characters in My Little Pony. When we do recordings in Vancouver, this is all an ensemble. And an ensemble is where the whole cast gets together. So all the characters record in 4 hours, the entire episode. And so we get to work off one another. We get to share, because in Toronto, in the shows, you come in by yourself, so no one else is there, and you're trying to imagine what the other characters are saying. But in My Little Pony reports, everyone is there. Everyone is there together, and we get to work off one another. And it's quite fascinating, because the music in My Little Pony, they'll have a musical director, two of them, they've got three writers, they've got the animation director, they've got so many people on the other side of the glass. And if you're lucky enough to participate, like some of the children or people that want to get a wish, get their little wings, they get to come in and record with us. They get to be a pony, or they get to direct us. They'll take on Terry's job, which he's the director. He's a wonderful director. but we'll let them share in the process, which is how do you think this character should stand? And so it becomes really fascinating because you would all have an opinion, I'm sure, of every episode you guys watch. They should have done this, or they could have done that, or I would have loved to have seen this, or what about that song, and why wasn't so-and-so singing that song?
I have an example. Look before you sleep, before the pillow dies.
Yes.
It tosses the pillow to rarity.
Yes.
But in my opinion, I think that would be a bit too fast.
Right, well those are the kind of things, like, and everybody has an opinion about how the story goes, because you want to be in the story yourself, so you all know what you'd love to see. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So the reports are fascinating. You cannot believe the things that go on in a report. And speaking of that, she's so naughty. She makes people laugh. She just will make you laugh before you have to say you're lying. So you're about to sin, she'll do something horrible, like burp. She goes, I'm very nasty today. She'll apologize for it. And it's unbelievable because she'll do it right before you have to pause. She pauses. And you go, it's nasty. I'm lying. And she's naughty because she also reads other characters that aren't there, like Tara Strong can't be there because she's in Los Angeles. So as a marker, she'll read the lines, but she'll make up naughty things in the lines. So just make people who have to respond laugh. She just does it to make everybody have fun, celebratory time. It's really fun. It's the most amazing job in the world. You guys, if you get a chance ever to animate the voice of a character, do it. You will love it. You will just love it. Tabitha brings cakes and cookies to every report, right? Every single one. Because in Vancouver, there's no food. I don't know what's wrong with Vancouver, but they don't bring any food. They don't give the actors any food. In Toronto, there's tons of food, and there's always food for the actors. So Tabitha will bring cookies and cakes for everybody every single day in the studio. She reports every single day. She brings cakes and cookies. Oh, that's so unfair. come on. What other characters? I love all the characters. Seriously, Big Mac. I love the voice of the wall. What I'm capable of is another question.
I think she was weird. She was human.
I would love to do a tiny little cutie voice. Like, Tanky Pie would be, in my wildest dreams, would be something I'd love to do. It's more like, right? So you could go with the wall. That would look at that too, the abandoned if you brought in that kind of thing. Well, I mean, all the basics are fantastic. Everybody, think about it. Who do you guys all like so much? If you were voicing.
I think I've got one.
Big, well, that's my character. Anybody, who would you voice? Somebody you call it out. Who is the last voice? Yeah. Who? Oh, see? Look at it. That's right. Yes, over here. All of them seem to be in the air, right? I know. That's perfect. What about this? Anybody else? What about
this?
Who? This door. This door. Yes, I mean, we all have homies up club. What have you got over here?
the impression.
Let's hear it. Let's hear it. What are you doing here? I love it. You're being cosplay. I love that it's on and stop the insanity. Like, that is so fantastic. What is happening here? There's a moving. This is beautiful. You guys are rocking it. So, Oh, yes, I do. So, yeah, you guys are all going to show me your voices. Don't think you're not. I'm going to come and find you to do it.
You want to hear my voice dancing in karaoke, then?
Yes, I heard that! Terrifies
me, karaoke.
Am I looking forward to singing? What about My Little Pony Movie 2? Ooh, I can't even talk about it! I just did a character that I had to sing. His name was Bubbles Peterbaum, and he was in the Cat in the Hat special. It's a little movie that was made in North America. And she had to sing with Martin Short. Anybody here know who Martin Short is? He's a comedian. He's a television film actor. And I had to sing with him, which was kind of scary. Because he's a big deal. I was like, hey, okay, great. But I'm a character singer, so what that means is I don't have to, whoa, like, opera's not my deal. I'm not that person. But I think the character can sing anything. Like, if you listen to the music in My Little Pony, and you look at some of the characters, they don't all sing their own songs. Like, Tabitha is a brilliant singer, and yet, Rarity, she doesn't sing Rarity's music. Or I could sing,
thank
you. Oh, thank you. Yeah, that's right. And other characters, like Pinkie Pie. Like, so, Andrea Lippman doesn't, she sings really well, but doesn't sing all of her songs.
She sings for the Brother.
Yeah, she does. It's so bizarre. Like, you go, what? And Shannon, yes, right. Exactly. So, I mean, the thing about music, I love lots of music in My Little Pony, right? It's fantastic, and there's going to be much more of it, FYI. Oh, that's what I was going to say. What?
I'm going to say,
yes. It's amazing, because they can all sing, but I don't know if it's that Hasbro wants to have very, yes. Yes. I don't know, there's no rhyme or reason to why that happens, but there's kind of a magic alchemical thing that happens inside of the show where different characters sing different songs, and it's just fantastic. So the music is a culmination of a lot of the musicality within the voice performers themselves, and they like to change it around. Oh, I'm going to tell her. You tell them that. Do they listen to us? No. We wish they did. But you guys, if you have ideas, really, I'm telling you, let them know. Because you are the show, as I said before, so your opinion about everything in the show, let Hasbro know. You know, go on Facebook, go on Twitter, go on whatever, and have an opinion. Have a say. They want to hear from you. They want to know what you love. They want to know, you know, what you feel about episodes, what you feel about characters. You know, what generation do you love? Why would you love to bring back a certain generation?
Like, for instance, I would like to see Tabitha. And Tabitha is like, yeah, his
way back. It was 2003 that she did that. But I mean, there's tons of characters that haven't come back, and they should. Like, who here has read the comic books? Anybody? Yeah. Right, well, there's so many, and they're just now going into another, you know, their seasons. You keep thinking, well, how are the stories going to change? Like, what's going to happen now? We've got Equestria Girls, we've got all kinds of breakouts, we've got, you know, all kinds of stuff going on. Here's your opinion. We really want to hear about how to do it. You guys have a voice. Yeah, feedback. You have a voice, and you have a venue to do it. Because it's all about communication, it's all about friendship, it's all about sharing what your thoughts are. What advice would I give to anyone who wants to start VA? Play. All it is play. We don't play anymore. We get too mature. We grow up very quickly in a world that is very dangerous. And we have a lot of attitude shifts in us. And I'm going to talk about this when I do the Voice of Voice class. We lose our ability to play. We get very serious. Which is why if you look in this fandom and you look around you, there's a sense of dressing up and a sense of celebrating and a sense of coming together and having fun and singing. And that's play. If you want to become a voice actor, do it. Get back to a sense of play. It's freeing. It's liberating. It's what connects us to one another. All you have to do is breathe. And guess what? We forget to breathe. And it's the most human thing that we got going. And to breathe in. If I take in a breath, you want what? Because you're hearing. You're hearing me. You go, what is happening? That is what we breathe out. That is what laughter is. It's to express air, is when we breathe out. That's breathing out, to breathe in. That's to inspire. If we breathe in, inspire. Breathe out. That's to express. So inspire and express. That's just breathing. And when we play, and we play harder, it becomes brighter, it becomes more celebratory, and that's what we all want to do. We stop breathing because we're afraid. So we get all tight, and we get tense, and we get shy, and we get nervous, and we stop breathing. Our breath is here. If you're feeling nervous, or you're feeling scared, or you're feeling unhappy, breathe! All you have to do is breathe! And as soon as you start breathing, you're going to start playing. And when you start playing, guess what happens? All fear melts away. All of your fear melts away. Because you don't worry about anything when you're playing. And that's what VAing is. It's playing. Yeah, why not? Do it. Want to hear it?
Hello, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
I am the new member. The Woody and Funkos! Today, I'm going to do a special thing. I seem to have left my magical kit somewhere, but I don't know where it is, so I'll just come behind you.
And you want to be like, oh no!
That's the least.
fine, you got it. We put all that energy straight forward, 7 inches from your mouth. That's where the microphone is. And you've got to guess why I open my mouth. Why? What is the only reason I ever open my mouth at a microphone? Anybody?
I just want to get rid of the dead.
The audience. But everybody forgets there is an audience because they're not there when you're recording. But I need to remember the only reason I'm opening my mouth is because of you guys. You're there. I have to be able to see you in my mind's eye. Millions of people that are watching the show. I've got to see you and I've got to hear you. I've got to be able to hear what you're saying. Be terrified. So I've got to know that you're sitting there sad, but don't be sad. And I've got to reach you so that when you watch the show, even though I'm playing a character, you go, I can hear, she's talking to me. She's talking to me. That's what the storyteller does. And it's difficult, right? To get through that microphone to a lot of people, to reach out and go, we need to be able to hear that. Our world needs to hear that. And it needs to hear, we need to hear it now more than ever. More than ever. Love your world. Treat everyone with dignity and respect. Then, you know what? You're part of a team. A big team that holds each other up. And nobody's left behind. We're stronger together. And we are a part. Okay. Oh, is it time for the bronies to ask me questions? Okay. Yeah, come on. Anybody want to ask? Who wants to ask a question about anything?
What can you tell us about the characters?
Nothing. Do you know what an NDA is? NDA is a non-disclosure agreement. Oh yeah. Do you know how I would be slaughtered? It's like everybody, we are not allowed to talk about anything until the show is here. Hasbro has us by the short curls. We are not, it's so crazy. We can, and we know things. But it's so hard to go. Yes, well, who knows, maybe. You all know there's stuff coming. You all know things are coming, we don't say it, I'm not saying it. But you all know some great stuff is coming, you guys. Some really great stuff. How do I feel so guilty? I can't. I feel like there's spies here that are actually watching me going, she said something! She said something! Yeah, look at me! Wait, you know, yeah, I'm a spy. I'm a dumb. How old is she? She's infinite because she's a legend, so she's timeless. She has no age. So she's like immortal, yeah. Her age is infinity. Is that such a thing?
And beyond.
Yeah, and beyond. Yeah, like all the legends, they don't have any. Although she looks and seems old. She's like, I don't know, Yoda. She's like, you know, think about any of the guardians.
What are the way he's dangerous then?
Yeah, well, you know.
Yeah.
Any kind of ethereal guardian, she's that. So she's a protector. So she's there always. She's like an angelic. Whatever you guys can imagine is something that is far-reaching and eternal that is there to always protect you. The legends are that in my little poem. So, yeah. But I like to think that she's 25. Well, come on, you guys. You know you want to ask questions. Don't be afraid. Yes. Yeah, right here.
How old are the main six?
The main six?
Yeah.
It's non-specific. They're never specific. Because as soon as you put an age to something, we as people assume different things. And again, the main six don't age. Have you noticed? They don't age, do they? How many years have we been looking at the main six? Not physically. So what do you think that means? Right. So there's no beginning and there's no end. It's a circle, right? There's no beginning and there's no end. So there's no real age because they exist in all time. No matter when. It'll just keep happening like a circle. Like if you look at the circle of friendship, right?
Yeah.
When they're all together, all the time, it's like that.
Well, so, we do know that flowers are a year older than Pinkie Pie.
That's right, but how old is Pinkie Pie? How old do you think she is? I mean, I know how old the voice actor is, but that's not how old the character is. Like, she's this eternal youth, is she not? Pinkie Pie is this eternal, fantastic, bubbly energy. They are representative. They are metaphoric in nature of a quality, each one of them, of a quality that we adore in real life, that we love to have around us. Each one of the characters, Fluttershy, all of them, rarely all of them. And we don't know specifically their age, I think because they are representative of an ideal that we want to also adhere to in our lives. Yes? He's got the microphone there.
What's your favorite non-pony species?
That's another hard one, because I love all the creatures. I call them my critters, right? But critters, like think about it. The birds, the anything. I mean, scaly claw. What about, you know, well, I guess James would have sort of something. But, like, you know, come on, they're spectacular. How do you pick? Do you say, I like this better? I like all of it for different reasons. They're all good. What's your favorite? See? That's what I'm saying. It's really hard. It's really hard. Does anybody have a favorite non-pony? Other, you know, like what? Changelings, there you go. And what are they? Exactly.
Griffins.
Yes, yes. What else?
Hippogriff.
Yes, come on.
Sirens.
Come on. Like, there's so many phenomenal creatures. Like, that's what we are. We're all uniquely different. Every single person in this room is so beautifully, uniquely different. Look around you. Look at your neighbors beside you. Look at everyone. Look at the cosplayers. What is happening? We are phenomenal creatures. Aren't we? We're all creatures. We're all different. We're all unique. No one better than the other. And that's why, you know, we're here, I think. For exactly that reason. We're fake. We love all of them. We can't. It's hard to pick, you know, but I like this. But I like that, too. But I don't know. It's so hard. Yeah, over here with a question.
When you record it. Can you deviate from the script at all when you're recording?
Yes. In My Little Pony, for example, Tabitha is so, she's a writer as well. Everybody deviates. We both only assist the script. We make it our own. So, but the writers are pretty heavy-handed about, they get paid a lot of money to write those words, but sometimes the words, you know, they don't know the character as well as the character. So Tabitha, Terry will just say to Tabitha, this is too wordy, that monologue that she has. Do your thing. And she will literally take a magic that she can do. And she just transforms the copy in front of your face to something completely different that is Rarity, because she knows Rarity. And she knows how she speaks, and she knows, and she can do it on the fly without thinking about it. And so, yeah, we deviate from the script. They don't let us deviate too much, because they're so particular, Hasbro, about what their writers say, and they have very specific writers that come in and do. But Terry has, he's sort of like the king, Terry. He'll go, this isn't working, it's too, it's not making sense, and I don't feel any heart in it. So he'll say, you guys, you know, just come up with something. So you'll have an idea of what should be said, more so than the writers, because the writers are not there. The writers don't work with the actors. They literally write something, it gets sent, and you go, my character wouldn't say that. That's so weird. She wouldn't say that.
So I'm guessing it's a delay.
Yeah. Like, it's not verbatim. We do not follow the script verbatim, but we stay quite close to it. Now, in Toronto and other shows, we have carte blanche. Like, they'll let us. I go to Disney Los Angeles when I audition for them. They will say, you know, pick two out of these 15 characters, and you have 3 to 5 minutes to do your audition. Do you think that I go in and pick two characters? I do all of them. 35 minutes later, there's no scripts left, and I'm just like, I'm doing all my, you know, whoever you go after, I'm doing my stuff, right? So they're like, they're just laughing on the other side of the glass. If you can spontaneously just thrive in a moment and go, ah, I mean, so much. Don't preempt what you're going to do. You just say, I'm going to celebrate my moment however I feel I want to celebrate. So, you know, you can do it, Hasbro, not so much, but you can do it, I would say, 100% of the time in all of it. Yeah, big time. Yeah.
So what was the most memorable moment in your voice acting career while recording, or sad, happy moment that you can talk about?
It's so hard again, because if you think about it, 37 years
probably in this business,
and thousands of characters, you love every single character for different reasons. Again, I'm going to come back to this. It's so hard to pick a favorite. One more moving, one funnier, one celebratory, one villainous. People don't like heroes. They like villains and sidekicks. And I don't know why that is. Everybody's sort of afraid of the hero, or they think you're boring or in tweed or something. And then you go, what do you mean? And I tend to like the heroes, because they're faithful, they're loving, they're kind, they're compassionate. They care more about how you feel than how they feel. And I think, as a voice actor, we need to be giving more of the heroes to everybody. I play a lot of them.
Have to stop by.
And I play a lot of male characters. I've got two new NDAs, and he hasn't talked about it, but these are big. So from Family Guy and Bob's Burgers, I don't know if you guys, it's a totally different kind of show. I've got two big shows coming up, and they're so, how should I say it, kind of violent. They're aggressive. They're kind of, the humor is kind of rude. And I have to do those shows, and then I do My Little Pony, and it's like they're two totally different genres of animated stories. And I feel like My Little Pony has somehow still captured the hero in a beautiful way, the hero and the heroine. It still celebrates heroes. And I find in our world, you know, I'm going to go back to it, the villain and the sidekick are the ones that we all go, I love him, oh yeah, 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 because they're bad or they're nasty or they're horrible, right? It's like, you look at something like, I don't know, Infinity Wars right now. Has anybody seen Infinity Wars here? Yeah. And it's so, you know, again, it's so violent, it's so cruel, and so hopeless. I don't want to give the away to those of you who haven't seen the movie yet. But it makes me sad, actually. I get overwhelmed, because you never want the evil to thrive. You don't want the bad to thrive, you want the good to thrive. You want the hero to come in. You want your to go, yay, yay, yes, please, in a world that is so desperately angry. When our stories become one where the villains are powerful and the villains are taking over, you go, oh, no. For me, although I love to play a villain because they're nasty, they're just like, you know, evil. So that becomes fun in a moment because you're so not that yourself, so you get to play something that you are not. But I think you want to play your hero. Look at anything. Like I always play characters. Like, does anybody remember the show Holy, Holy, Holy?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, I played Benita Baxter, who was the mom of the little square head. So they all had round heads. Every character in Holy, Holy, Holy had round heads. But my son and my husband and myself had square heads. So we were the oddballs. We were like, what, we weren't balls, we were odd squares. And in that kind of a show, to be square, I think, you know, it said so much to people. It said, it's okay. And his best friend was Rolling. So, you know, to have Rolling to accept a little square-headed boy when everybody has round heads. And this is an older person, but for me, it won a lot of Emmy Awards, that show. And playing the mother, I got to say some beautiful things about being different. And I really loved that show. I really, really did. I played a sushi piece, too, called Shmanky De Sue. And she had a twin sister. I know, it's so crazy, a sushi piece. And her twin sister was really beautiful, and Shmanky De Sue, the sushi piece, was really not beautiful. So her twin sister was really beautiful, and she wasn't. And she used to pick up gum off the sidewalk and chew it, and she used to keep her toenail clippings in her wallet. Like, she was a really quirky little character, and I really loved her. I really loved her. Her teeth were going in, you know, she's a sushi, little sushi piece with teeth going in different directions. And she had wonderful things also to say about beauty. It's interesting now that I think back on all the characters I've played. A lot of them are about, it's funny, a lot of characters that I have voiced are quite strong and beautiful because they're different. So I think, you know, again, coming back to favorites, there's just been so many Red Ball, like so many characters, so many shows. And when you try to remember the roles, you become kind of, it's like I've done 300 productions in theater, and people always ask me what's your favorite character in theater, and again, it's very difficult to pick because they're all beautiful for different reasons. You know that you're really close enough. Anybody else? Yeah. Is this thing on?
I've got another one.
Okay, sorry.
How about your like in real life moments? What's your like favorite? What's your like most memorable moment?
In a recording
in
studio?
While you were recording.
I've got to say my favorite moment was when I first did My Little Pony with Tabitha. Only because my best friend was introduced, I'm gonna start crying. My best friend is introducing me as her favorite. And it was really magical. It was really beautiful to have somebody that I love and respect introduced me, and I'm in the studio with her, voicing the character that is her favorite. It was like magic. It was so much fun. Yeah, it was. It's really like you can't make that kind of story up, right? Now my mascara is going to start running. Oh, look at how. Okay. Yeah, what happened to the thing? Okay, I'm just asking. Okay, that was for me my favorite moment. And that was just a couple of years ago that we recorded season 7.
So probably time for one more question if anybody has a quick one they'd like to ask.
So, what was the worst experience you had till now?
There's no worst experiences. So, are you talking about in the studio?
Yes. Any massive major flops or any extreme disappointments or something?
There have been a couple of somebody's vomited, full out, full projectile vomited out in the middle of nowhere, in the middle of a take, all over the music stand. I don't know if anybody here knows Dwayne Hill, but he's a big voice guy out of New York City, and we were recording, I can't even remember the show, this is several years ago now, and the director was grumpy, and was not happy, and kept picking on him, and saying, it's just not working, what's wrong, the director was a female, and she finally goes, and everybody, we all start to get nervous. When somebody starts getting picked on, the rest of the cast gets kind of nervous for the person that's being picked on. Because you feel like they're not doing anything wrong, they're trying their hardest to give it everything that they've got, and you just start to get nervous. And the actor then starts to lose their mojo. Like they actually get nervous, they start feeling, oh, I'm not doing it right, oh, I'm in trouble, oh, it's not good, oh, well, this is not a good situation, and they start then making mistakes. So it's a bad slippery slope. And she was picking on him and picking on him. She makes people cry, this one director. She's really hard on him. And it's hard when you're an actor because you're trying to give your best and somebody starts to, you know, go at you saying you're not very good. That doesn't help you. Like, be better. And all of a sudden, you know, she said, did you read the script? And you have to read the script. And he went to this one. He pulls off his headphones, picks up a thing. He goes, girl, like, what's happening? He goes to the door, turns around, he goes, I didn't read the script. And he walks out of the door, meaning, you read the script on your own time, so I'm going to go home and I'm going to read the script, because she was so insulting. And he left, and we were all there like this. What just happened? And we had to continue on without him. And it was one of those moments where, and yet brilliant moments where somebody who was being picked on took control of the situation and went, wait a minute here. Oh, are you going to blame this on me? I'm going to go home and read the script because that's what I do on my own time. Of course he had to. But it was just, he was fed up, and we all got very nervous in the moment of like, oh, this somebody's really going to get in trouble here. This is not a good situation. But at the same time, it was like, yeah, you don't deserve to be beaten up for something you're trying to do. So, there's been many other moments too that are just like. I could go on about moments in the studio, but I mean, I would say 99.9% of the time, it is a celebratory, phenomenal experience to go in. And it's just like stuff happens, right? Stuff happens. But it's what you bring to the fore that is going to make it good. If you bring your fear to the microphone, then you're going to give fear to the people. If you bring your depression or your anger or your faithlessness to the microphone, then you're going to give that to the people. And that's not what we want to give to the people. What we want to give to the people is hope and a door. And hopefully that's what you're getting. Hopefully when you watch my microphone, you recognize that all of the voice actors in the show are reaching through the void to all of you and going, we do this because of you. That is the only reason we voice at all is because of you guys. We love you.
As well.
Yeah.
And so firstly, can we just give it up again for Ellen Ray?